Dear students, welcome to today's lecture on CARES Risk Assessment. I'm Dr. Pawan Kumar. And what is CARES Risk Assessment? It is nothing but a determination of likelihood of the increasing incidence of CARES during a certain time period, or likelihood that there will be a change in the size or activity of the lesion already present. In other words, it is the chance of increased occurrence of caries over a period of time in individual or progression of a size of the lesion. The purpose of the CARES risk assessment is to determine the risk status of an individual, to educate him to preventive measures, and to plan the treatment procedure or management of the CARES patient, and also devising the new diagnostic tools. Factors that affect caries risk are generally clinical factors, risk factors or risk determinants which directly influence the caries process. They are frequent intake of sugars, formation of mature cariogenic biofilm, reduced salivary flow, and acidic pH of biofilm. The factors that does not influence the caries but does not cause the caries but influence the course of disease progress are confounders or risk indicators. They are socioeconomic status, knowledge, awareness, and attitudes of the individual towards the caries disease progression. The protective factors include the general oral healthcare procedures and frequency of visiting dental care provider, and also fluoride in water intake and frequency of brushing with fluoridated toothpaste. Based on all these factors, the individual can be grouped as low risk group, high risk group, and moderate risk groups. To assess the caries risk, many tools or many methods have been implemented. They are questionnaire, American Caries Risk Assessment Form devised by American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry, Kellogram Model, Caries Assessment and Risk Evaluation Test, Caries Management by Risk Assessment, and Traffic Light. Taking the questionnaire from an individual which is about maternal dental history, family dynamics, socioeconomic factors, and oral hygiene measures, fluoride exposure, and frequency of sugar exposures. In addition to all these factors, clinical observations made by visual, tactile, or radiographic methods determine the risk of the patient. After the risk factor is achieved, and it is in use to educate the patient and also to manage for preventing the disease progression. American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry has developed a caries assessment form, which is caries risk assessment tool. It generally consists of clinical conditions, environmental characteristics. Clinical conditions includes the development of caries risk, caries teeth within 24 months or 12 to 24 months. When there is no development of caries in teeth for past 24 months, they are categorized as a low risk group. When there is no enamel demineralization, and there is no visible plaque or no gingivitis. When there is caries occurrence in at least 24 months and there is an area of enamel demineralization and presence of gingivitis, the patient comes under moderate risk. High caries teeth in past 12 months and more than one area of enamel demineralization and visible plaque on anterior teeth and radiographic enamel caries. High titers or midden streptococci determine the high risk patients. Environmental factors includes the systemic and topical fluoride exposures, rates of the individual, and also socio-economic status of caries for caretaker and presence of caries in the siblings or caretaker, and also frequency of intake of sugars. These determines and regular visits to the dental care. These determines low risk factor. When there is regular dental visits and mid-level caregiver socioeconomic status and 1 to 2 simple sugar consumption in between meals, there is moderate risk of development of caries. Whereas in high risk caries, there is frequency of meal in frequency of exposure to the simple sugars in between the meals is greater than 3, and caregiver socioeconomic status less than is low level, and there is no use of dental services, and there are active lesions in the mother, caries lesions in the mother. And general health conditions that determine the caries are when there is child with special health care needs, and also the conditions that imply the salivary consumption and flow. Presence of any one of these risk factors in high risk group, then the patient is considered a high risk, and moderate is presence of any one of the moderate risk indicators and no high risk indicators results in moderate risk classification, and low risk is a child does not have moderate risk or high risk indicators. Cariogram. This was an algorithmic model developed by Brothel with quantitatively weighs all contributory factors to the dental caries, and the green area present in this chart determines the chances of an individual to avoid the caries lesions development, whereas dark blue area determines the diet factor, where the frequency of intake of sugar and the quality of the sugars that are taken constitutes the diet, and bacteria is red, and quantity of the bacteria and susceptibility of an individual is considered as a light blue area, and circumstances such as a combination of past caries experience and related diseases will come under yellow sector. When all these sectors reduce in size, the green sector size increases, thereby showing that there is chance of avoiding new caries activities is more. Caries assessment and risk evaluation. This was developed by Southern California School of Dentistry, and it is the first test that determines the caries risk of an individual even at the primary level itself, that means before the development of any risk, before or without the presence of any risk factors itself. In this, there is a this test determines that there is a high correlation between the presence of salivary oligosaccharides and certain oligosaccharides and caries activity is present. Caries activity. Certain salivary oligosaccharides are known to facilitate bacterial attachment and colonization on the salivary pellicle, while certain oligosaccharides promotes agglutination and removal of the free bacteria. It determines the genetic risk of child to develop caries. Caries risk management by risk assessment. In this tool, what will happen is we take the dental and medical history and conduct a clinical examination and detect the caries lesions and assess and document the risk categories as low, medium, high and extreme caries risk measure, and then these information is used for preparing a treatment plan, and also that includes the chemical therapy appropriate to caries risk levels, and also recall the review interviews appropriate to the caries risk status. That means the recall should be planned a shorter period for the individuals of high caries risk when compared to the individuals of the low caries risk. So this includes disease indicators like new caries activity lesions, new white spot lesions on the smooth surface, new non-cavitated lesions in enamel, existing restorations in last 3 years or last year. Presence of any of these indicators will place the patient or individual in high risk group. Biologic or environmental risk factors include carcinogenic bacteria that is measured quantitatively, heavy plaque on the tooth, frequent snacking greater than 3 times daily, hyposalivatory medications, reduced salivary flow, deep pit and fissures, recreational drug use and exposure tooth roots and orthodontic appliances present in the oral cavity. If all these are present, then S is marked and this determines the moderate risk factors. And protective factors that include fluoridated water, use of fluoridated toothpaste once or twice daily, and 5000 ppm fluoride toothpaste is used, and fluoride varnishes application in dental setup in previous 6 months, and use of fluoride mouth rinses and chlorhexidine gluconate daily also determines that the patient is in low risk status. Presence of any one of the high presence of reduced salivary flow plus the high risk factors indicates that the patient is at extreme risk category. Presence of any one of the high risk factor determines the patient is in high risk category. So by showing this risk status to an individual, we can educate him and help him to come from to progress from high risk status to the low risk status. So similar is designed for the similar caries risk assessment form is designed to a children of 0 to 5 years of age which includes biological or environmental risk factors, includes frequent snacking more than thrice daily, use of bottle sugars, and presence of caries lesions in mother or sibling, and low socioeconomic status, and use of the medication that reduces salivations. Presence of any one of these may indicate the moderate risk. And protective factors include if the children is used living in a fluoridated area, drinks the fluoridated water, and fluoridated toothpaste is used at least twice daily, and fluoride varnish is applied in the last 6 months. If there is presence of carcinogenic bacteria and heavy plaque, then it is moderate risk category, and evidence of tooth decay or white spot on clinical examination, and it is high risk category, and recent gestations in 2 years or the last year, it also comes under high risk category. Based on the information, we can determine whether the patient is in high risk or low risk or moderate risk. High risk, low risk patients generally do not require any treatment, and they are told to continue in the same manner or to carry out their daily activities in the same manner, and are asked to revisit the dentist every 12 months. In moderate risk patients, they are asked to revisit the dentist for evaluation every 6 months, and they are educated about decreasing the amount of sugar intake in between the meals to less than 3, and also use of fluoridated mouth rinses every daily. In addition to this, high risk individuals are advocated daily use of fluoride-resistant mouthwashes, and also the minimum invasive technique for halting the disease progression. So another model is traffic light signal matrix. This is followed in Australia. In this category, the system consists of 5 different categories. Saliva, where resting saliva in which unstimulated saliva rate less than 0.1 ml is considered as high risk category. When more than 7.7 ml, less than 0.7 ml is considered as high risk category. Which is determined by the red light, and then the moderate risk category is yellow, and then low risk category is green. Fluoride is exposure to fluoride through water, toothpaste, or professional treatment, and modified practice like that reduces salivary flow and diseases resulting in dry mouth. Fixed or removable appliances, recent activity caries, and poor compliances. Caries activity is determined as increment of caries lesions over a stated period of time. Caries susceptibility is the susceptibility of a tooth to a caries producing environment. Tests which measures the caries activity are lactobacillus count, streptococcus mutans levels, streptococcus mutans screening test, Alban's test, Devon's test, swab test, and salivary buffer capacities test. In lactobacillus colony count test, lactobacillus count test is to estimate the number of estrogenic and esphoric bacteria. In this, the number of colonies bacteria in patients means in this test, the number of estrogenic and esphoric bacteria present in the patient's saliva are counted by using the number of estrogenic and esophagic bacteria in patient saliva can be obtained by counting the number of colonies that are appearing on tomato paper and other plates after inoculation with a sample of saliva. So the procedure that involves is patient chews a small piece of paraffin, that means it is a wax. Okay, the saliva accumulates for about 3 to 3 minutes period, and it is collected in a sterile container and is shaken well. And then saliva is diluted to 1 to 10 dilutions per sterile solution and then 1 to 1000 dilutions. The 0.4 ml of each dilution is spread on the surface of a cup plate containing 20 ml of liquefied agar and then incubated for about 3 to 4 days. After the incubation period, the colonies are counted using light and large magnification glass. Number of lactobacillus per mm saliva is calculated by multiplying the number of saliva colonies on the plate by dilution factor, and this determines the number is correlated with the caries activity. 0 to 1000 indicates no caries activity. 1000 up to 5000 indicates light caries activity. 5000 to 10000 indicates moderate caries activity, and greater than 10000 indicates marked caries activities. Coming to advantages of this is monitoring it monitors the effectiveness of respiratory dentistry and is simple to carry out in a large group of patients. But disadvantages is takes few minutes to test, but results are several days, and do not completely exclude the growth of other acidic organisms. It is inaccurate for predicting the onset of diseases. Streptococcus levels in saliva can be estimated by incubation of Mitis streptococcus mutans on Mitis salivaris agar with the addition of high concentration of sucrose and 0.2 basic tracin suppress the growth of most of non-mutant streptococcus colonies. In this, the sample is collected by using tongue blade and then incubated on the Mitis salivaris agar for about 48 hours, and levels of streptococcus greater than 10 to the power of 5 ml per ml of saliva indicates high caries activity. Calorimetric Schneider test. In this, the ability of the salivary microorganisms to form the organic acid from a carbohydrate medium. The medium contains an indicated dye, bromocrystalline. This dye changes color from green to yellow when pH changes from 5.84 to 3.8, which indirectly measures the number of both acidic and estrogenic organisms in saliva. Procedure: 0.2 ml of stimulated saliva collected by chewing the paraffin before breakfast is mixed with 10 ml melted agar containing medium in test tube. Allowed to survey, then inoculated at 37 degrees. Amount of acid produced by estrogenic organisms is detected by changes in pH indicator and is compared to uninoculated control tubes after 24, 48 and 72 hours. The rate of color change from green to yellow is indicative of degree of caries activity. So, when I indicated changes to yellow within 24 hours, then the caries susceptibility is marked. When indicator changes from 48 to yellow within 48 hours, then the caries susceptibility is definite. When changes to yellow in 72 hours, is caries susceptibility is limited. When there is no color change even after 72 hours, then the subject is said to be caries inactive. Salivary buffering capacity test. This test measures the number of millimeters of the acid required to lower the pH of saliva. So, then greater the number of milliliters of acid required to lower the pH from 6 to 7, the lesser the caries activity in an individual. So, procedure involves: a 10 ml of stimulated saliva is collected under oil at least 1 hour before eating, and 5 ml of this is measured into beaker. After correcting the pH means to room temperature. Room temperature, the pH of saliva is adjusted to 7 by addition of lactic acid or base. The lactic acid is then added to sample until a pH of 6 is reached. The number of milliliters of lactic acid needed to reduce the pH from 7 to 6 is a measure of buffering capacity. Saliva of individuals whose mouth contain a considerable number of caries lesions frequency has high caries activity and low buffering capacity. Salivary reductase test measures the activity of salivary reductase enzyme by using diazo resorcinol dye. Saliva is collected in a plastic container. The sample is then mixed with the dye. Caries congenitalis is measured by color change seen after 15 minutes. Interpretation is evaluation is based on color change. When the bacteria, when the caries activity is not conducive to, when the saliva is non-conducive to caries, then the within 15 minutes there is no blue, the color of the indicator is blue. And the orchid within 15 minutes determine that the slightly conducive to caries, and red changes to saliva, if changes to red color within 15 minutes then it is said to be moderately conducive to caries activity. And if the saliva turns immediately to red, then it is highly conducive to caries. And if it immediately turns to pink or white, then it is extremely conducive to caries. Four-disc caries calcium dissolution test. These measurements of amount of powdered enamel dissolved in 4 hours by acid formula and patient saliva is mixed with the glucose and powdered enamel. This gives the caries as the amount of the procedure involves the saliva is stimulated by having the patient to chew the gum or paraffin, and 2.5 ml of saliva is collected. One part of this is used to analyze the calcium content, and remaining is taken into 18 sterile test tube in which 0.1 gram of powdered enamel is added. The test tube is sealed and shaken for 4 hours at body temperature, then calcium content is analyzed. When the paraffin is used to stimulate saliva, 5% glucose is added. Interpretation: greater the calcium release occurs, the greater will be the caries activity, and it is used in limited studies and correlated report is good. Disadvantages are requires complex equipment and trained personnel and is expensive. This ends the lecture, but there is something we have to do. First, we assess the caries risk of an individual by taking the questionnaire and placing whether it is whether he is in high risk or low risk or moderate risk, depending upon the number of caries lesions present and low socioeconomic status of an individual and amount of caries. Filled teeth or missing teeth present in an individual, and this is followed by when all the individuals when the risk factor is evaluated, the microbiological test can be conducted in individual basis in case of high risk categories.